I graduated with a math degree, so nothing to do with pro-life, and that made me even more scared. I wasn't a counselor. I wasn't a nurse. I wasn't a doctor. I knew nothing about the pro-life movement, and yet I knew I had to go. I decided I was going to start on June 11, 2016, and I told everyone in my life I was going to go. I told my friends, my family, my college professors. I told everyone in my life, I'm going to run across America. And people constantly ask me the same questions. Where's the money going to come from? I don't know. What are you going to eat as you go? I don't know. Where are you going to stay? I don't know, but I know I'm going to go, and I know it's going to happen, and I know God's going to provide. And that was always my answer. And the reason I was so firm in that is because in America alone, we have lost 60 million children to abortion. Now, when we study the Holocaust, we learn that we lost 6 million Jews, and that grieves us to today, and it should. But does abortion grieve you? Does the loss of 10 times that number in America, 60 million, does that grieve you? Does that even make you think or bat an eyelash? Are we too distracted with our own missions and our own goals to realize that children are dying every single day in the United States? But when someone tells me a number like 60 million, I can't wrap my mind around it. I can't understand how many 60 million is. I can't imagine how many people that would be. So I want to break that down for you. That is 3,300 children who will die every day in America alone. That's not even worldwide statistics. That's just the United States, 3,300 children. If you break that down one more time, that is one child who will die every 30 seconds. Every 30 seconds, another child will lose its life to abortion in America. So like I said, my team and I told everybody that we were going to go, and I was going to run across America, and I told you I was going to start on June 11th. But June 11th came and went, and no money came in. None, not at all. I'd been working on this project for 2 years, and still no money had come in. And I still had no vehicle, and I still had no place to stay. But I was determined that I would go. And so my team and I, we spent hours every single day sitting at our desks. We were so broke, I graduated college, I didn't move out of my parents' house. I stayed in my parents' house for that summer. And I worked every single day, asking churches, calling people across America, any organizations, will you help me accomplish this goal? Will you give me a place to stay? Will you give me a place to speak? And as you can imagine, most of them said no. But I knew I was going to go, so I just decided I'd pick a date, and I couldn't afford to make it to either coast, so I would start right where I was from. And I told you I'm from Kansas, so I just decided I would run as far from my parents' house as I possibly could. And when I ran out of money, I had $200 at that point, when I ran out of money, I would come home. And I knew I had done everything I could to run across America. Sounds pretty lofty, right? Almost a little foolish. Just run from your parents' house? Well, I did. They let me borrow their car, and I began running. And I'd been training for a long time, but I found out I was not in good enough shape. It's very different running a half marathon or a marathon even. But when you try to do it every single day, it's a lot more difficult. But I began training, and I started running from my parents' house, and I'd run about 10 miles, and then someone would come pick me up in the car, and I'd stay the night at my parents' house. And the next day, I'd go out again and again and again until the commute became about 2 hours. And I was like, well, we're going to have a party, and we're going to tell everybody that we're really leaving because I can't come home anymore, and I don't really know what we're going to do, but it's going to work. Didn't have enough money again to rent a venue, so I asked my old high school if I could use their band room to have a party in to tell everybody about the run across America, and I stood up in front of all of them like I am you today, and I told them again, full-heartedly believing it, I'm going to run across America. I gave a speech trying to inspire them to donate money and stand behind me with prayer as I went. And at the end of that day, God brought in $2,000 and a conversion van. That's actually our conversion van in that picture. It's from 1989, so that was exciting. The couple in the picture is my kindergarten teacher and my science teacher. They donated it to borrow, basically until it died because it was very old. But that gave me a place to live, right? In the back of a conversion van? Yeah, I lived in that with my team. We varied between 3 people and 4 people as we went across America. As I went across Kansas, my first state, it was about 400 miles long. We had nowhere to stay. No one allowed us to stay in their homes, so there's a bed in the back. So the 3 girls on my team, my sister, Sarah, and my teammate, Megan, and I would sleep in the bed. And then my little brother, Nick, who became my running partner, would actually sleep on the roof all across America as we went. And this is not at all what I envisioned when God called me to go. Either we were on the side of the road, or we'd been in a Walmart parking lot. It was so different than I anticipated, but I knew I could make a difference if I just kept being faithful, and no matter how many times it felt like I had fallen down, I would rise again. Now, in the next picture, that's my little brother and I. Nick is his name. He is the most intense athlete you will ever meet. He is constantly climbing trees, gymnastics, he does everything. And he became my running trainer, basically. I was too lazy after running that many miles to do any sort of stretching, and he made sure I was responsible. Now, if you see I'm emptying a Campbell's soup can into a pot, you probably wondered how I ate. My parents bought us that Coleman cook stove, and we ate off of a Coleman cook stove or over an open fire for almost the entirety of our journey. We cooked things like soup, beans, we just poured it all into a pot. We'd boil it. By the time we were done running that many miles, we thought it was the best food we'd ever had. The back of the van you can see is right now our picnic table, and it doubled into our bed at night. As I ran across Kansas, we realized that we were not going to have an opportunity to shower because we didn't have any hosts. We averaged a shower once a week across America. It's pretty gross, right? Yeah. Imagine being the one who went through it. It was pretty awful. I remember we saw this lake in Kansas, and if you know Kansas terrain, there's not very many. And we got so excited because it meant we could wash our hair. So we washed our hair in that lake and kept going, and I kept running. And with that high of mileage, a lake was better than nothing. We kept going, and God kept bringing in just enough money to keep us going, keep gas in our big van's tank, and keep food on our bed, I guess. And God kept us going. It was amazing. Now, the next picture I want to show you is when we were cooking over an open fire. I don't know if you can see, I'm kind of tiny in the background, but sometimes to make ourselves feel like we had a little bit of a home, we'd set up a tent, we'd build a fire, we'd set all of our goods out, and then we felt like we had a home for a while. And we'd live in a tent in the wilderness, and I would run, and we'd just drive to my running location, and then we'd come back and live in our tent. It was an amazing experience. And for someone who loves adventure, it was a phenomenal experience for me. There were so many difficult times about this. Honestly, being homeless was never what I anticipated when I told people I was going to run across America. Honestly, I don't think I would have followed through if I knew some of the things I'd have to go through. The judgment you have to face when you're in that situation, even though I'm doing it as an option, I could be doing something with math, I could be doing something that's giving me money, but I knew to be a leader, I'd have to make sacrifices, and my team knew that to make a difference, they would have to make sacrifices, and some of those entailed living in this van. The one thing that is extremely difficult about abortion are the lies that women are told that surround abortion. When a woman walks into an abortion clinic, she's told that an abortion is an easy and clean procedure. Now, I'm not going to be violent or graphic because I don't think that's effective, but it's not clean, and it's not easy. I've personally walked a woman through delivering her unborn child, and it was not easy, and it was not clean. It was very difficult. And that woman still struggles with that, even to today. When women walk into a facility, they're told it is a clump of cells or a blob of tissue, and that when the abortion is over, it'll have seemed as simple as a dental procedure. But it's simply not true. Women struggle with abortions for the rest of their lives. A lot of women, right afterwards, especially when they're teenagers, say, "I don't struggle with abortion. I had one, been there, done that, it doesn't bother me." But on average, women don't start feeling the regrets of an abortion for up to 5 to 20 years later. Now, a lot of people say it's just a clump of cells. And so I find this image wonderful. If it'll... Okay, well, oh, there it is. So it's just, I found it almost humorous. It says clumps of cells and there are many stages. So we have the first cell or zygote, and then we have the developing embryo, and then we have an infant or a one-year-old. It goes all the way through till it's an elderly lady. And it's just saying, we're all clumps of cells, guys. You can say that it's a clump of cells or a blob of tissue, but believe it or not, that's all that we are as well. So it's a silly argument, and you will hear it so many times, but I hope this silly image breaks it down a little bit for you. That's all that we all are, is a clump of cells in our different stages of life. But before we had ultrasounds and before we had the technology, people really believed that it was just a blob of tissue, that it was nothing, that it didn't matter, and that it wasn't a human being. But now that we have so much technology, These old myths are falling away. One piece of technology that just recently came out that I mean, if I get the blessing of having kids sometime in the future, I'm definitely going to want to have. Women can actually have an ultrasound belt. It came out in Australia. They can wear it for up to 20 minutes a day, and they literally can put an ultrasound belt on their stomach and walk around town and show people what their babies are doing. Maybe their baby's sucking its thumb. Maybe their baby's sleeping and not being active. Maybe their baby's kicking and moving around. That's phenomenal. And being able to see inside the womb, if you saw a woman's baby jumping up and down and kicking, you're gonna be like, oh, nice clump of cells in there. No, you're gonna say, wow, like when are you due? How old is your baby? Wow, how long has it been kicking? It's opening people's eyes because people are so visual. Things like this, if people see the truth, their eyes will be open. So I want to encourage you, show people the truth. The abortion debate doesn't have to be this dark and scary debate. You can simply show them in love the beauty of life in the womb, and you can change people's hearts. Another lie I want to address is abortion affects only me. So if I get pregnant, whether it's a mistake, whether I'm in college, whether I have two kids and I don't want a third, whatever reason, I can tell you abortion affects only me, right? No, abortion affects the father, abortion affects the grandparents, the cousins, everyone around them who lost that person. But someone that people typically forget that abortion affects, I think is made clear in this image. Abortions kill generations. Have you guys ever thought about these children that because of that one abortion don't exist? People have started calling these children the ghost children because no one even thinks about them. I can tell you 60 million have been killed. But now how many families have been destroyed? How many spouses are without theirs because of who have been aborted? And this is a rather conservative drawing. I gave that first child only 3 kids, and then pretty much 3 kids all the way down until the third generation when one of them has 6. But it's still extremely conservative because 2 of the children didn't even have kids, which isn't very likely. Abortion affects people for generations. It affects ingenuity, it affects creativity. It is phenomenal what happens when you abort one child and the difference that one child's life had on all those around it. One of the hardest things I've ever done was when I was in Chattanooga, Tennessee, I went to a place called the Unborn Memorial. It was so difficult. I actually went there with a girl who had an abortion. And I remember as I walked in, I'll show you the picture. As I walked in, on the left-hand picture, those are all plaques of mothers or fathers or grandparents who now regret their abortions. Hundreds of them. If you see the picture on the right, that's me standing in front of them to give you a little bit of perspective of how many there were. But it went all the way down to the right and all the way down to the left, on and on and on. Now, if you look at that shelf, on that shelf there are stuffed animals, there are dolls, there are letters, there are pictures, there are verses of all these grieving parents who are so affected by their abortion. So when people say that abortion doesn't affect women and it's as simple as a dental procedure, does anybody you know ever grieve that tooth they lost? No. But these people are grieving their children for years and years. Now, if you see in this picture, there's a ball and a glove. And that one really hit me. And as I looked at that, I began to tear up. Because underneath it, there was a letter from a father. And he was regretting never being able to play catch with that son who he'd aborted. It affects people whether they're vocal about it or not. Who's going to be vocal about this in their life? Who's going to want to come forward and say, yes, this is a problem for me? It's very few. This one is actually a letter on an abortion receipt. I can't quite tell, but the abortionist had circled between 6 and 7 weeks. I'm not going to read you the letter, but essentially what happened is the boyfriend had just started dating his girlfriend and she had found out she was pregnant from her previous boyfriend. And this new boyfriend didn't want to lose her, so he took her to the abortion clinic and paid for her an abortion. And in this letter, he's grieving it, and he's saying how selfish he was because he was afraid to lose the new girl in his life, that he was willing to take another life. And he's still grieving it. He kept that receipt and wrote this unborn child, a letter on it. He is still grieving. Another one that's extremely difficult is a letter that I read, and it's a mom talking. She wrote a letter to her daughter, and she talked about what a beautiful young lady she thought she would have become. She said she'd been grieving her for every birthday for 18 years. Her daughter would be 18. How many of you are 18 in here? Anybody 18? Yeah, I think that letter was pretty recent. Was of your year that child was aborted. And she's still grieving. She's still wondering what her daughter would have looked like, who she would have been, who she would have married, what her grandkids would have looked like. Yes, abortion affects you. It does. But it also affects everyone around you. It affects siblings. It's been proven that in families where the children know that their parents had abortions, the children are more afraid of their parents because that love bond has been cut. A lot of times in those types of homes, the abuse rate goes up because if one child was worth so little, then what are my other children worth? There are a lot of hard things to work through with the abortion movement and a lot of hard things you have to address as you work through this topic. One of the hardest parts of the run across America for me was when I came to Colorado. Now, if you know your geography well, or at least at all, you'll know that the Rockies are there. I was terrified. I'm from Kansas. Did I tell you that? Yeah, it's flat, as can be. It's not a rumor. It really is flat. And I'd run all the way across that, and as I approached the Rockies, it was still flat. And then all of a sudden, I'm supposed to run at 11,000 plus feet. How on earth am I supposed to do this? And I became afraid. Were these obstacles in this run too great for me? A Kansas girl running up Monarch Pass was the next pass I was going to have to climb. That pass was 11,312 feet. It had a 20-mile approach. I had to go 20 miles uphill until I reached that elevation height. And I was supposed to conquer this. This was just another part of the journey that most people wouldn't even know I went through. As I ran up Monarch Pass, terrified and not sure if I'd make it, it began to rain. And that rain slowly turned to sleet and snow. My lungs burned and my legs burned. I just kept telling myself, one more switchback, just one more. Just try one more time, just one more mile. And I'd always tell myself that as I ran. And I remember when I finished running up Monarch Pass, and I stood on top of that pass, here I am with my brother and my teammate Megan, 11,312 feet. And I can't tell you that I was so happy that I had defeated what I had been so afraid of. What had scared me so much, I was able to put beneath my feet. And I remember as I turned around and I looked over my shoulder, there was a rainbow. And I don't know how much you know about the Bible, but the rainbow is God's promise to be faithful. And God was faithful that no matter how many times I had fallen, no matter how many tears I had shed in conquering mountains, that God was going to be faithful to help me. So in the abortion movement, there are a lot of lies. There are lots of things you have to work through and lots of things you're going to have to find and weed your way through. But God will be faithful and he will give you strength to conquer the mountains. And when you're fearful, when you're afraid of what people will say, when you're afraid of their arguments, when you're afraid that they might have had an abortion, know that speaking truth and speaking in love is going to be the best cure and the best way to end abortion in America. Now, with abortion, the reality is that people aren't recognizing the value of life in the womb. I think that's the basic argument of it all. If people would start studying life in the womb and the beauty there, then their eyes would be so open to what they're actually doing. My favorite fact about fetal development is actually the very moment of conception. Life begins then. My life began then. Your life began then. Did you know when you were conceived, all 46 chromosomes were in place? Now, when people tell me that, I'm like, wait, what does that actually mean? What do you mean, all 46 chromosomes? It means everything about you, everything that makes you who you are physically was already determined when you were one cell big. When you were smaller than a grain of sugar, you were exactly who you were going to be, and your body knew exactly how to make you into that person. So when I was one cell big, my body already knew I would have blonde hair, and knew I'd have size 8 feet, and knew I'd be about 5'4", and knew everything about me, even the sound of my laughter. I was a distinct human being, even when I was one cell big. And all I needed was the right environment and for no interruption to grow into exactly who I am today. Now, if you think about it, it makes it a little more personal. Think about the fact that all of you were one cell big at one point in time. All of you were not human clump of cells at some point in time. But would you argue for yourself now in retrospect that you were valuable? That you were going to be someone someday? That you're going to be a flourishing high school student? It's a lot more personal when you think about it in terms of yourself. The next thing I want to share with you is that 18 to 21 days, we have a fetal heartbeat. It's phenomenal. The heart that starts beating at 18 to 21 days will be that same heartbeat for the rest of your lives until your death. One powerful demonstration of the fetal heartbeat was actually in Chile. In Chile, they're having the same debate, pro-life or pro-choice. But the women there got pretty smart, I think. They decided that instead of walking through the streets and yelling things or saying anything at all, they instead were going to hook up megaphones to their stomachs. And they were going to march through the streets, playing their baby's heartbeats over the megaphones as they marched. They walked through the streets without a single word, and all that echoed from those megaphones was the bump of their actual fetal heartbeats inside of them. It's an amazing protest, and they decided to take advantage of that. Now, fast forward to 8 weeks. Every organ is in place and growing. Now, the next one I think is pretty cute. It's a baby sucking her thumb. Now, a lot of people kind of see this as a nuisance, right? You have to break your babies of this habit or can mess up their teeth and their good jaws and everything. But did you know it's actually not the parent's fault that the baby sucks their thumb? At 9 weeks old in the womb, so, I mean, I know it's kind of hard to see, I didn't bring my models with me. That's about a 9-week-old baby. It's already sucking its thumb. Isn't that amazing? And this is what we see, and we can see it's so human because it's outside the womb and in front of us. But even inside the womb, that baby's already sucking its thumb. At 14 weeks, the baby's facial muscles are moving. Whenever I teach elementary students about pro-life, I always make them smile and frown. And I'm like, isn't that amazing? You could do that before you were born. I mean, you probably didn't know what they meant, but you were making those facial movements already inside the womb. Now, I don't know about you guys, but I love sweets, and it's probably a good thing I'm a runner because I love candy, I love cookies, I love chocolate in particular, any type of sweets, I love it. Now, before I was even born, I already had a sweet tooth. According to NetMums, a baby inside the womb already has a sweet tooth. They have proven that the fluid that that baby drinks, if they put in any other flavor, bitter, salty, any other flavor, the baby will not consume as much fluid than if it is a sweet fluid. The baby already had a sweet tooth before it was born. Now, we all know that we all have unique fingerprints that show exactly who we are, and people can use them in crime. I mean, I'm pretty sure it won't be important when you're 17 weeks old, but that's when you actually developed your fingerprints, was at 17 weeks. At 23 weeks, you're starting to recognize car alarms and dog barks. So not only your mother's voice, but you're starting to recognize outside noises. And you know, a lot of times, I don't know, girls can jump pretty easily. I can be kind of jumpy sometimes. If a car honks at me, I kind of like jump, or if I'm running and people honk at me while I'm running, I kind of jump, it like terrifies me. In the womb, the baby's already starting to do those same movements. When a dog barks and it's afraid, or a car alarm goes off and it's afraid, the baby will actually jolt in the womb because it's afraid. It's human, just like us, just like me, just like you. The next one is that your baby can already cry in the womb at 26 weeks. Now, it can actually make the noise, but it's starting to practice that vital form of communication, right? How do we know when to feed our babies or lay them down or change them? As they're growing up, it's one of the most vital forms of communication that they have before they can learn how to speak. Now, the next one I'll show you is actually an ultrasound. I mean, it's not an ultrasound, sorry. It's an MRI scan of a baby inside the womb. And hopefully it'll play. Okay, well, in this MRI scan, it is phenomenal. So this baby, as you can see, is in what you call the fetal position, because that's where you get it from, is in the womb. And the video is not going to play, but what the baby does is it will extend its legs fully and stand up completely. I mean, it has to stick its head sideways, but it's straightening out its legs. And again, whenever I teach elementary students, I always joke that the baby's doing aerobics. It's stretching, it's kicking, it's moving, it's bouncing up and down. It's learning how to use all these muscles and develop. So when it's outside the womb, it's ready. It's ready to be held. It's ready to learn about its outside environment. It's amazing what's going on. Another thing I think is adorable, and the last fact I'm going to share with you, is that at 32 weeks, your baby thinks you're funny. Isn't that amazing? I mean, men, excuse this real fast. Women, can you imagine that your baby inside of you thinks you're funny? That's amazing. Now, they've proven that when they've done ultrasounds, and when women laugh, and sometimes their husband, when that woman laughs, the baby will bounce up and down with pleasure on the ultrasound, showing the pleasure that it has to the sound of its mother's laughter. It's its response and the beauty of that laughter and the connection that it already has with its mother. Now, getting people to recognize this truth is extremely difficult. If you walk around and tell people life begins at conception, I mean, I told my taxi driver that on the way here, it didn't go over very well. It's difficult. It takes a lot of discussion, a lot of education, a lot of work, but it's worth it. After I finished running across Colorado, the next state I had was Utah. Now, I promise you my geography is better than I'm gonna let on right now, but when I thought I finished Colorado that I was gonna be in California, and I knew it wasn't. Like, I knew I had three states in between, but for some reason those states just seemed so small compared to Kansas and Colorado, but Utah was not. Utah was so big and long, and it was covered in canyons. Now, I wanna show you a picture of Utah. Now, this is my brother and I overlooking those canyons. Now, if you see those mountains in the background, I had run from those mountains to the point I was standing. I'd run all the way through those canyons, and that was just a little taste of what I was going through on the Burr Trail through Utah. I started in the summer in Kansas, and then moved into the fall in Colorado, and then into the deep winter. Now, if you know anything about the desert, it is freezing cold rather than hot if it's the winter. And as we slept in our van at night, it was terribly cold. Lots of nights below zero. As I went to sleep, I would pull on two pairs of leggings, a pair of sweats, a sweater, a jacket, a parka. I'd wear a neck mask, or a scarf. I'd wear a face mask. I'd wear ear warmers, everything to keep myself warm. And then a lot of times, I would curl down deep into my sleeping bag because it was easier not to breathe than to shiver so hard. My water bottles literally froze next to me in my sleep. Ice formed on the inside of our windshield, and in the mornings, we'd have to scrape it off before we could proceed. It was difficult. It was hard. There were times where we ran out of water, but we knew God would carry us on, and despite the difficulties and despite the hardships, God would make a way for us to continue. One really exciting time was we decided that we didn't want to live in our van, and we wanted to set up our tent for a while, and we were on public lands. So we did. We set up our tent. We set it off far back from the road in a kind of a nest of trees. It was beautiful. Burned out all the cactus, so we wouldn't step on any. We built a bonfire pit. We built a lean-to and put all of our supplies underneath it. Then we set up our camp. That night as we were going to bed, we were several hundred miles away from a gas station, but we knew that we were running low on water. We'd been carrying 5, 6, and 7 gallon containers of water, so about this big, for us to drink, for us to wash our dishes with, and for us to cook with. Everything we needed, whether it was drinking tea or running and needing to drink about 2 liters every run, had to come from that water supply. And if we ran out, we didn't have any. We went to bed with peace, though, knowing that God would provide, knowing that God would make a way in whatever way he had to. I woke up in the middle of the night in that tent, and the tent had actually collapsed on us. Now, I told you my brother's an outdoorsman, so you think he'd build it better than that. But then I realized the tent had collapsed because of snow. Several inches of snow had fallen on our tent and caused it to collapse on us. So I literally had to stand up and beat the snow off of our tent before exiting. And the next morning, we were able to take our pots and pans and gather snow, tons and tons of snow, melt it over the fire, and then we were no longer out of water. It was difficult, but God made a way. God provided that we could continue on. He gave us enough wisdom to gather snow so we'd have enough drinking water, dishwashing water. I even got to have as much hot chocolate that night as I wanted. It was amazing. God provides, and he'll make a way, even when it's hard and even when you're trying to show the truth behind what abortion actually is. I want to tell you guys, don't believe the lie. A lot of times when women walk into abortion clinics, they feel coerced or forced. And if that is their only choice, if they feel like that's their only choice, do they really have a choice? If that's the only option? And the answer is no. Women feel like, I can't finish college if I have this child. My boyfriend will leave me if I have this child. My family will be upset and kick me out if I have this child. There are so many circumstances where women feel forced or pressured into having an abortion. But I want to tell you today that abortion does not fix your problems. Abortion is not an easy way out. It's an easy way out of the easy social pressures that are around you at that moment. But the fruit that you're reaping is so much longer. The grieving that you and your boyfriend or whoever's involved, the girl who drove you to the clinic maybe, I've been through that situation. Someone took someone to a clinic and they were grieving over having helped. There are so many things that compile when it comes to the pro-life movement and when it comes to abortion that you have to be willing to think through. That it's not this easy way out, this easy fix. Taking a human life is never an easy fix. Women live with this decision for the rest of their lives. I want to take here and just pause and know that Christ does forgive, that there is forgiveness, and that you can be healed even after abortions or even after helping someone have an abortion. There is forgiveness in Jesus Christ. I did a lot of research, obviously, before setting out on this run, whether it was fetal development, the specific moment of conception, birth, anything. But one thing that was really hard for me to study was women's testimonies after having an abortion. I'm not going to read any of them to you because I don't have enough time, but I just want to read you the titles of a few of them. One woman's title of her synopsis, basically, of abortion was, "I couldn't look at any kids." The next one is, "Nobody said it would hurt so much." The next one, "They didn't give me any other choices." "He'd be 20 years old today." "The feeling of a loss of a child will always be there." And the last one, "I'm all alone." If your friends or you or someone you know are ever in this situation, know that parenting or adoptions are always the best option. College can wait a semester or two. The social pressures will pass. But knowing you made the right decision is something you will be able to happily live with for the rest of your life. Making the right decision and helping and counseling people who are in that situation in the right direction will be something you'll be able to be proud of when you look back on your life and your life's history. There is so much hope in the pro-life movement. So many things are changing. Laws are being overturned. In Mississippi, it just became the most conservative state. It doesn't allow abortions anymore after 15 weeks. It's amazing. The most conservative state in the U.S. Kentucky is currently fighting to become pretty close to that. They're trying to shut down all of their abortion clinics. I actually had the privilege of sitting in on the court case that happened, I believe, back in September. The judge hasn't ruled on it yet, but basically Planned Parenthood and the women's facility, I can't think of the name, are both under criticism for not having proper transportation for their abortion patients if something goes wrong. Kentucky is fighting a very difficult battle to shut both of the clinics down in order to make their state the first state to have no abortion clinics in the United States. It's amazing. Things are changing, and there is so much hope. One awesome story of hope was actually came from a mechanic. You know how I showed you that picture of that 1989 van? And you know how I told you running through the canyons was hard for me? Can you imagine how our van was making it? It literally was from 1989. It got like 8 to 10 miles per gallon. It was so bad. Like, that's where a lot of our money went. But as it was coming up these canyon roads and these cutouts and these highways and everything, it was having so much trouble. In the state of Utah alone, it broke down 5 times. That's expensive, especially when you're working on a van from the 80s. They don't have that many parts for them anymore, to be honest. A lot of people were looking in junkyards. But a mechanic came and he fixed our van, and it was $1,100 worth of work. And we were overwhelmed. $1,100? Where's that money supposed to come from? How are we supposed to pay for this fix? But when he gave us our bill, it was a bill of $0.00. And the reason for that is because his daughter had been through an unplanned pregnancy, and someone had come alongside of her, a pregnancy center had, and had showed her hope, and had showed her that abortion wasn't the option she had to go with, and had enabled her to choose life in a difficult situation. And now he enabled us to continue on and gave us hope that people did care and that we were making a difference. There's a lot more of the run left, but I won't go into much more detail, but I basically finished Utah, finished California, jumped in the Pacific Ocean. It was phenomenal. I can't tell you how good it felt to jump in the water. My brother and I hugged, and then I almost got ripped under by a rip current, actually. Not from California. It's like my third time seeing the ocean. So it was very difficult. But we made it. And then we turned around and we drove all the way back to Kansas. I did not run back. Drove back to Kansas, and I was just going to start again on the Kansas-Missouri border. And I did. And as I ran, my knees hurt so badly. They ached with every run. I could only hit about 3 to 5 miles before having extensive pain. And I realized that if I was going to finish the last 1,200 miles of this project, running that little wasn't going to work out. So after advice from a doctor and some x-rays, my board and my parents, I ended up switching to biking, which was very difficult. I'd already run 1,700 miles. I wasn't going to quit for anything. But my doctor basically told me if I didn't stop running, then I wouldn't run ever again. And I love running. So I stopped. And I started biking. I biked the last 1,200 miles. People had heard enough about our project that support started coming in left and right from all over. People started opening up their homes. So all of our hotel costs, we got it. Like I told you, we showered once a week. That's because we got a hotel once a week for a shower. We ended up having hardly any hotel costs because people opened up their homes, allowed us to shower there. They fed us. Our expenses became basically non-existent. We could speak to so many people and keep traveling and educating and activating people almost expense-free because of people opening their homes across America. It was amazing. The first bike I started out on was actually an old bike my mom bought at a garage sale. And I wasn't a cyclist, you know. I was always afraid that they were going to be really judgmental. And they were. I started out in tennis shoes with no helmet on an old bike, biking across Missouri. And I went into this bike shop, and this guy basically was like, "You're a joke, go home." And I was like, "I biked across Missouri." And I was determined. Nothing, like, it wasn't going to stop me. I knew my cause was greater than any silly bike guy's judgment of my bicycle. I did get some bicycling shorts and a helmet, which was probably wisdom. And when I hit Indiana, Illinois area, one of my friend's dads actually donated his bike, and I was so excited. It was a guy's bike, so again, I got mocked for that, but I didn't care. It was a road bike this time, and I was flying. When I hit West Virginia, if you guys know your geography and terrain again, it was extremely mountainous, but I was so excited to conquer another mountain chain in my last one of the project. And right before I hit those mountains, I got a little snobby in the biking community. Someone ended up donating a $2,000 bike to me, a bike that was made out of the material that they make jets out of. I literally can lift the bike with one finger. It was phenomenal. I basically was only propelling my own weight to the mountains. God provided again and again. And I remember when I finally made it to Washington, D.C., my finish was going to be the ocean beyond that, but my exciting point was the Lincoln Memorial because of what Lincoln had stood for, the freedom of an oppressed group of people. I loved that. I loved the symbolism in the Lincoln Memorial. And actually, as I biked up to the Lincoln Memorial, I got a flat tire about a quarter mile away. Oh, it was exciting, but I pushed my bike through all that traffic and was trying to, like, run because I hadn't walked any, not a single step. So I was like, well, I'm like kind of running, walking my bike, I don't know, through traffic. I made it to the Lincoln Memorial and eventually to the ocean to jump in. And it was one of the most exciting times. I'd spoken over 70 times across America to all different groups. I'd educated and activated so many people. And it was all because of that quote by Nathaniel Green. And I'll read it one more time. It says, "We fight, get beat, rise, and fight again." So I want to encourage you when it comes to being a leader, I want to encourage you that when it comes to ending abortion, remember that quote, that when you get beat, you must rise again. And not only rise, but you must keep fighting. Because if you don't, the oppression of the unborn will continue. And they will continue at the rate of 3,300 every single day. And unless you make a difference in the United States for these children, unless you are the ones who rise up and make a difference and stand for these children, then no one will. They will go on dying every day like they are. And yeah, there'll be difficulties, I can tell you. But God will make a way. And he will enable you to end abortion and end it in our generation. Thank you. Thank you so much. Now, I'd like to open it up for questions. We don't have a ton of time. I think we have 10 minutes. So if there are a few questions, I will do my best.
Hello. My name is Chase Irwin. I'm from Templeton, California. What is your stance on birth control devices, such as condoms and over-the-counter pills and stuff?
Okay, so birth control is definitely something I kind of steer clear of. My passion is definitely abortion. If you're messing with those kinds of things, my advice is make sure they're not abortifacients. What does that actually mean? That means that if you're taking a pill and it says that it is basically preventing conception, make sure they know what the definition of conception is. A lot of people don't. A lot of times an abortion pill will line the uterine wall with a type of mucus, and it will allow the baby who's already conceived, and like we learned today, that's already a human being, and that baby is trying to then implant on the uterine wall to grow and develop. With that mucus on the uterine wall, the baby can no longer develop, and it will pass. It will try to implant on that wall, the mucus will prevent it, and it will pass, and just pass like any other egg would out of a woman. It's an abortion just the same. Now, I am not for birth control. I'm engaged, my fiance and I have already had the conversation. I don't think it's right. I don't think it's biblical. But a lot of times I just say, think through it. Think through the health effects of what birth control can do to you, how it affects you and your husband's relationship. A lot of women suffer with personality dysfunctions after taking birth control. Sometimes in different cases, difficulty having pregnancies later, which is something you never want to mess with. The gift of being able to have children is amazing, and to give that up over right timing I think is wrong. I think a lot of birth control has come out of the idea that life isn't valuable, and that children aren't convenient, but I want us to be a culture that values life and that sees the beauty of children and that realizes that they are the up-and-coming Americans. They are the ones who are going to make a difference in the world. And if we value them, then they will be able to. And if we set this 5-year rule, I can't have two kids until 5 years into marriage or 2 years because it's not convenient for me, then I think you're definitely getting into a sticky situation. But I definitely recommend having that conversation with your spouse someday.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
My name is Sean Ward. I'm from Long Beach, California. I go to McBride High School. My question is for you is, how would you respond to the leftist argument that many people bring up is that women need to have access to abortion because if they're in economic hardships, the child will be born into poverty and basically live a terrible life?
All right. So I have a 2-year-old, not really, but hypothetically, I have a 2-year-old. I'm really hard up for my finances. Can I kill that child? Okay, how about a 1-year-old? Guys, I cannot afford him. Can I kill him? How about a 1-week-old? He's 1 week old outside the womb. Can I kill him? 9 months gestation. So he hasn't been born yet. Can I kill him? No. Let's bring it back even further to about the point of viability. 20 weeks old. It's getting tricky. Can I kill him? My point in that is, at what point can I draw the line that a human's life is valuable or not valuable? At what point can I say, you matter now, but not then? You matter 2 days earlier, 2 days later, but not 2 days earlier. Your life doesn't have value because of a certain characteristic you have or a certain brainwave activity that you have or whether your heartbeat has started. Why can I draw the line then? And when you can answer me that, then we can talk about my 1-year-old and 2-year-old and go further.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Liam Gallagher, Louisville, Kentucky. Go to the state of Kentucky. So kind of on his question about economic hardships, one thing that is another common argument is that conservatives not only just, they just care about the baby while it's in the womb. How do we defeat the argument that we just do not care about the baby after it's out of the womb?
Okay, I work and partner with a lot of organizations that do care about that. I work with a lot of adoption agencies, and then foster care. My church right now is actually doing a foster care program where we're collecting pajamas for foster care children. Just because you have a specific care that's abortion, I'd rather them not be killed, and I think that's more of an important issue than the difficulties of foster care, doesn't mean that you're wrong. I mean, people tell me that all the time. I get it probably a weekly on Facebook. What about foster care? Like, you clearly don't care. And my response is, just because I'm focused on one thing, specifically children who are being dismembered and poisoned, because that's my passion, doesn't mean that I don't care about the foster care children. It just means that if I started focusing on birth control, if I started focusing on abortion like I am, and then I started focusing on foster care, then why not once they age out of foster care? Who cares about them once they age out? And then what about when they're middle-aged and they don't have money because they got fired from a job? You can go through everybody's stages of life, all the way up until when they're in a nursing home, and you can ask them that same question. What are you doing about it? Just because you have a specific care for one thing doesn't mean the other things don't matter. It just means it's not your specific calling. Very good question.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Hi, I'm Mike Kunkel. I go to Viola Youth Academics. And I have a question about stem cells. And okay. I've done some research on stem cells and how it can, cure Alzheimer's and cancer and pretty much almost every disease we know of. So what is your opinion on using embryonic stem cells to save, thousands of lives?
Okay, comparing it to the Nazis is a little harsh, but whenever they were operating and taking parts of human beings and studying it, what did we do with that information? Do you know? We took that information and we discarded it because it was gained in an immoral way. So can I take these embryos, who are human beings, dissect them, take their stem cells for the betterment of some other people? When the contradiction to me is, it'll better their lives someday, well, I kill this child today. You are killing a human being. And Francis Beckwith's Defending Life book, his whole theme again and again throughout the book is the question, when does life begin? And if you can always bring people back to the point of conception, you realize that all other arguments fall apart. Embryonic, rape, incest, anything, they all fall apart when you ask people the simple question, when does life begin?
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Hi, my name's Steven. I'm from Irvine, California. How should we respond when people say that, specifically the left says that we're forcing a woman who is raped or incest, you know, some horrible thing, we're forcing her to have the baby as opposed to do something that would, you know, out of a hardship that wasn't her choice?
Yeah. So an abortion in a situation where you weren't sleeping around, you got pregnant, and it wasn't your fault. It was already a brutal attack. The woman's going through a lot in that moment. And then we force her to keep the kid. How is this just? Well, first of all, I want to tell you that abortions are, for cases of rape and incest included, are less than 0.1%. So it's a very small number, so don't make that your argument for having legal abortions for all 9 months, killing 60 million children. It doesn't make any sense to me. But that's what a lot of leftists try to do, is take that one argument and spread it and project it to the many. And then my second point with that is, a lot of people call it a double rape. When a woman is raped, yes, I'm so sorry that they've been through that, and it is one of the most wretched things that can happen to a human being. But then the abortion on top of that, women have started calling a double rape. Because not only did they have that forced on them, but then what they thought was their cure, they actually brought on themselves. I watched this hour-long documentary compiled of women, story after story after story, of women who came forward and said, I was raped, and I kept my child, and my child is actually what helped me heal from the abortion. The child was the beautiful thing out of that rape. And again, women came forward and said how much it helped them heal from the rape. And I think that's what God intends, is yes, it's a terrible situation, but there's so much healing that can come from that life. Does that help, or you have one more follow-up? Okay.
That's it.
Thank you, Stephen.
Hi, my name is Joseph Reichel. I'm from California, San Diego. I've been to about 2 or 3 pro-life marches and gotten yelled at, but I was going to Starbucks, and a lady with 4 kids yelled at me because I had one of those choose life signs, and so she said, well, what if the baby is born in an area where the baby won't be happy or won't survive or will starve or suffer a lot? And she said, then it's better to kill the baby so it won't have to suffer. She had 4 kids, so I felt like I didn't really agree with her, but I was like, okay, because I don't have any kids, so I can't really say anything to that. But what would your answer? My question is, what would your response be if you got asked that question?
Okay, I'm going to actually deal with your second point really fast. You said, I don't have any kids, I can't deal with that. So men, I want to talk to you really fast. You're going to hear that a lot, right? You're a man, you can never get pregnant, so leave me alone, right? Again and again. I want to tell you that human rights issues about future men and future women are your issue just as much. Just because you cannot get pregnant doesn't mean you can't know what is right or wrong. You can make a stand and you can make a difference in the pro-life movement. Be brave, and when someone tells you that argument, then simply say, let's put that aside, because we can argue logically without throwing that in. Yes, that is true, I cannot get pregnant as a man, but walk the argument through with them and educate them in kindness and in humility, and you can open their eyes. And then the hardship part, like kind of like what I explained earlier, with they're going to be in foster care, or they're going to be in a poor, low-income family, or they might be abused. I still think of an abused person, personally speaking to abuse, like knowing abused people who've gone through abortions and things like that, I think they still value their lives despite the hard hardships that they've been through, or deformities. Their life is more complicated than other people's, but their life still is valuable and still does have importance. And a lot of people who have the hardest lives sometimes become some of the best people, and even when they don't, most of them say, I'm glad I'm alive. Just because I didn't have enough money to eat while I was growing up doesn't mean I wished I was aborted. I mean, break it down, bring it back to when does life begin, and ask them that question. Ask them to draw a distinct line for you, and then break that down from there.
Thank you.